Shalom, real quick, giving all praise to Yahweh Bashem El Shai Bashem Rukakwadash Shalom to the 144,000 rest of the elect out there. Shalom to all. I'm going to make this super quick. I'm going to title this video, All Wickedness is But Little to the Wickedness of a Woman. So this is a video that came across. I'd only watched not even 3 minutes of it, and they go right in. So this is After Hours with Anton Daniels. And you might remember him. He came against the Israelites. Certain brothers was out there in Detroit. He's talking all manner of crap about him. But this is what he said and his experience dealing with women. So this is his video. These are guests. He says 98% of women are evil. Anton, Slimy, Quentin, Debate. If there be, and these are the other three. I guess he's Slimy and I guess he's Quentin. If there are any more pure ladies in the world. So this is his topic. He kicked it off. And you listen to it, listen to the video After Hours. I subscribe to him. Just to get ideas. He claims to be a Christian, you know, and he talked bad about Israelites in general because he doesn't understand. You know, he doesn't understand. He doesn't understand what this world's coming to. That he doesn't understand or realize that he's going to have to take a chip if he wants to keep all that money and keep what he got. He doesn't understand that this is Babylon the Great and is going to be utterly destroyed in a coming third world war of Armageddon. So he really doesn't understand. Like I said, he has said he's a Christian. He said he's a Christian. A legitimate, run-of-the-mill Christian. So this is the topic. 98. So we're talking out of 100 women, only two of them you might be able to trust. What did King Solomon say? Which is Yahweh Shai coming back in a previous life. He said he counted the women out of 1,000, he found none. Out of 1,000 men, he only found one. So Solomon went a step deeper. He said none of them was right. It said 98%. That's a big number. 90, if somebody says, if you go in this town right here, you got a 98% chance that you're going to make it out of there in one piece. You're going to go up in there, you might die. So if you believe what the person said, you're not going up in there. It's total lawlessness going on in that particular town. So it's about a 90% chance you ain't going to make it. 98% of women, all women, are evil. And he explains it in his video. I don't got to watch the rest of this. Anton, Slimy, and Quentin debate if there are any more pure ladies in the world. So when you deal with a woman, she's either lying to you, she got a man, but she gonna move on, she tired of the dude. So she's with, but in the meanwhile, she's saying she ain't got a man. She get with you, she get a little tight, she get frisky. She wants to deal with some other guy at the job, so she doesn't tell you. They're just wicked. You know, that's why in the ancient world you had harems. And the men that controlled the harems were eunuchs. They had their rods chopped off. So the only men that was in there were men that had their rods chopped off. They go into that history, which there were concubines. Harems was a house of women that was either set up in different rooms, and their sole purpose was for you to have sex with them. Look, go into the history of harems. Matter of fact, you know what? Let me do this. So he's pretty much sounding like an Israelite. Why you think we don't got no women around us in the GMS. Now, women, they open to listen, you know. They're clearly open to listen because you got some, the elect are among the women and the children as well. Okay, let me do this. Where am I going to go? Let me deal with the word harem. Come on now. I'll give you a couple of precepts, mainly from the Apocrypha. What is a harem? So let's get the definition.
Here's the definition. In former times, the separate part of a Muslim household reserved for wives, concubines, and female servants.
Okay. Harem refers to domestic spaces that are reserved for the women of the house in a Muslim family. And this was not just a Muslim, this is in the ancient world, ancient custom. A harem may house a man's wife or wives. In the kingdom, we're going to have wives. We're going to have wives and concubines. We're going to have women of the other nations. They're prepubescent male children, unmarried daughters, female domestic servants, cooks and so forth, house cleaners. And we're going to have servants. We're going to have people cleaning our houses, our castles, cooking for us. And then you're going to have women of the other nation that you're just going to deal with on a sexual level. And other unmarried female relatives. In the past, harems also house enslaved concubines. Enslaved concubines. Now, Esau in slavery, they called them fancy girls. I look up the word fancy girls. Let me see what it says. Fancy girls in slavery. Okay.
According to National Museum of African American History and Culture, during the domestic slave trade, a new category of enslaved women emerged, known as fancy girls. Young and usually light-skinned, these black women were purchased explicitly for sexual exploitation, at rates 4 to 5 times the price of women field laborers.
Did you hear that? So they were expensive. Now you had these two devils, these slave masters, that was their business. They would sell these fancy girls to Edomite plantation owners. So they made sure they got the light skin that had Edomite features to them. During the domestic slave trade, which is talking about Jake, Deuteronomy 28 and 68, a new category of enslaved women emerged, known as fancy girls. Young and usually light-skinned, these black women, which were Israelites, were purchased explicitly for the sole reason for sexual exploitation. That's a harem. That's a harem. That's the job of a concubine. At rates 4 to 5 times the price of women field laborers. So if you purchase a woman that wasn't all that pretty, you put it out there in the field to work in the field with the field Negro. And let's say it was $1,000 for that slave. You know, she 11 years old, you work her, you may get, you know, 30 years out of her. So that's an investment right there. Now, the fancy girls, there were four to five times more than that. So we're talking about 5,000. But the number was even higher. You had to be a rich plantation owner to really purchase a fancy girl. Let me see. Let me do this. So they have fancy girls. We're going to have fancy girls. We're going to have women of other nations. What is a fancy girl in slavery? Slavery history. The South established markets that sold enslaved women for the explicit purpose of sex, and so-called, which are concubines, fancy girls, markets, principally in southern port cities, enslaved women could be bought to serve as the sexual concubines of one man, or to be prostitutes in the more contemporary understanding of the term. Go with a name for girls in slavery. The most common 603 names of the female slaves were Bet, Mary, Jane, Hannah, Betty, Sarah, Phyllis, Nan, Peg, and Sari. Let me look at a couple more. Fancy girl, plural, fancy girls, historically a female slave kept for sex, a concubine. So you had, in the history of man, you always had men, the one that was rich, they might have had their wives, a show wife or whatever, but they had concubines, they had harems. They got that from the ancient world. So that's where a woman's supposed to be. A woman's not supposed to have a career. Her career is supposed to be to a man. So now let me come back over here. Where am I? I'm sorry. Let me do this. Okay, so it says here, right? It says, Proverbs 30 and 20, such is the way of an adulterous woman. She eateth and wipeth her mouth and saith, I have done no wickedness. Hey, it's best not for you to have a woman, like Paul said. It's best not for you to have a woman. You talking about you having a lovely marriage, she's working overtime. Oh, I got to work overtime again. It says, Ecclesiasticus 25, verse 19, all wickedness is but little to the wickedness of a woman. Let the portion of a sinner fall upon her. All wickedness is but little to the wickedness of a woman. So we're going to open this up. Let's go to context. I'm sorry, let's go to the whole chapter. Okay, the wickedness of a woman changeth her face and darkens her countenance like sackcloth. Her husband shall sit among his neighbors, and when he heareth it, it shall aside bitterly, because she was out there. And they know that she was out there, and it comes back to him. That's why the law of adultery, a woman steps out on a man, a husband, she was put to death to put away wickedness in Israel. It says, all wickedness is but little to the wickedness of a woman. Let the portion of a sinner fall upon her. As the climbing up of a sandy way is the feet of the aged, so is a wife full of words to a quiet man. I know there's a friend of mine's older sister married this man. He was a quiet man, and she forced this guy to kill himself. She was an overbearing woman. Let me go to the chapter, so I'm 20th verse. I'm going to make this short. Cut this short. 21. Stumble not at the beauty of a woman, and desire her not for pleasure. In other words, a woman that looks good and you and what she got, the box is good, so to speak, don't get married because of that. Get married because of the, let's use the word, integrity of a woman, if she's got any. It tells you that in Proverbs 31 about a virtuous woman. I meant to say virtuous woman. It says a woman, Judith in the Apocrypha, her husband died of a heat stroke, and she was the one that chopped Holofernes' head off because of her beauty. He got this dude drunk, and when he laid down, she chopped the damn head off and brought it back in a basket, and it uplifted the hearts of the Israelite men. This was during the time period of the Babylonians going into the Persian and the Medes. That's in the book of Judith. Now, she said when her husband died, she said, I'm not, and she was a perfect woman. She was beyond beautiful. She was a beautiful woman. So when her husband died, she said, I'm not going to deal with a man even till my death. But she played that dude so she can get in there and chop this guy's head off. So she's a great woman in Israel. Do you remember the woman with the seven sons that refused to eat pork? She's a great woman in Israel. It said, a wicked woman abateth the courage, maketh an heavy countenance, and a wounded heart. A woman that will not comfort her husband in distress maketh weak hands and feeble knees. Now the woman came to beginning the sin, and through her we all die. Give the water no passage, neither a wicked woman liberty to gad abroad. And your woman's not supposed to have male friends, period. If she go not as thou wouldest have her, cut her off from thy flesh, and give her a bill of divorce, and let her go. Now, Yahweh Shai said, the only way you can cut her off is if she's committing the act of adultery. So what this means is, if she go not as thou wouldest have her, ultimately, if she's dealing with another man, it's right here. It says, give the water no passes, neither a wicked woman liberty to gather abroad. Let me do this. Arrow. It should be in the same chapter or the 26th chapter. How do we spell arrow? I think it's RR. RR. Modify Apocrypha. That's 26th chapter. She will open her mouth as a thirsty traveler when he had found a fountain. And we know what that means. And drink off every water. You know what that means, near her, by every hedge will she sit down and open her quiver, you know what that means, against every arrow. You know what the arrow means. And you have that among Jake women, among East, it's big among Edomite women. Jake women do it, won't say nothing, but Edomite women do it, and they'll brag about it. They'll go on TikTok and so forth, on YouTube, and he'll brag that in 20, this one woman, she said she, her goal was to get with 20 men in 20 days, and she wound up getting with like 22, 23 men. And so she'll meet you, she'll get with you, and then she'll ghost you, whatever the term is. You know, you get the number, and all of a sudden, because that all she wanted was to lay down with you so she can write that down. So these women are completely out of order. You see, Jake, men don't want to deal with the Jake women no more because they're completely out of order. So this is a cycle. This is like order out of chaos. The fact that the Jake women and Jake men are not together, Jake men don't want to deal with the women. They'll get passports, go to other countries. These women are lonely here. So now they got to do what's called a attitude adjustment, a complete attitude adjustment. But that's going to come in the kingdom. And we are going to have more than one woman on this side and many, many women on the other side, which includes concubines and so forth. Women of the other nations that are concubines. Because a piece of the kingdom was here for 40 years when Solomon was on the... So Solomon had 1,000 women. We're going to have more than Solomon. And if you have a child by a woman of another nation, that's an Israelite any goddamn way. Anyway, with that, I'm going to say shalom. I'm on to the next one. Shalom.